Hi, everyone. Peter Saville. Okay, should we leave it there?
Yeah. Good idea.
So, Professor Peter Saville. I mean, if you look at page 33 in the agenda, you'll see some background on him. So I'm not going to go through all of that, except to say that obviously he's extremely well known in this profession. He's got, you know, more letters than most people after his name. He's founded and sold two extremely successful companies. And he left Saville Consulting on the 18th of November, 2015. So what's that, 5-6 days ago? And I imagine you have new pursuits. He's married to Jermaine. He has 5 kids and about 10 grandchildren, he said.
a last count, yeah.
I'll just name his kids, Christopher, Francis, William, and more recently, twins Jack and Faye. He's absolutely mad on sport, both as a player and as a supporter, and was chair of a football club, right?
Yeah, two.
Of two football clubs.
Three, actually. Three.
Now, I've been talking to Peter a lot over the last probably 3 months, because he likes to talk. I've been looking for things that we have in common. So I'm thinking if I can find some, that's probably a good thing. So, he's beaten me on the who you went to school with thing, because he was at school with Jimmy Page. and I only go as far as David Walliams, so it's not too bad, but not quite in the same league. We both I live in Chiswick now, and he grew up in and around Shepherd's Bush, which is very close. So that's about as far as I got with the connections, but there are at least some. So he also has written a chapter with a colleague,
Tom Hopton,
with Tom in the book. So, you know, why we're doing this, there's a number of reasons, but, you know, when we were talking about doing some sort of keynote, you know, Peter said, well, let's make it around what the subject of the book is, which is leadership, entrepreneurship, and chairing a PLC. So it's ended up merging and moving from that, and it's a little bit about the story of Peter's life, but through the lens of, obviously, psychometrics, leadership, and entrepreneurship. So your role, guys, in this is to seek out those little messages and insights that, you know, make you think and kind of strike you. Okay, that's all I'd ask you to do, because I think it's going to be full of them, if it's anything like the conversations that we've had on the phone in preparation for this. So I'm now going to shut up. 2 days ago, I said, and then say something. 2 days ago, Peter Peter called me and was saying, you know, I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to do this because he's had a viral infection. So thank you very much for being here, and I will start by saying, how are you?
I'm much better, but I've got a croaky voice. And I'm blaming it on the new puppy my 6-year-old twins wanted here, because when we got her, she actually had a bad virus. And my wife called the doctor out on Saturday morning, and she actually said I could have caught the virus from the poor little puppy. But she's a lot better now. It's an old English sheepdog that we've actually got around the house.
And how are you feeling right now?
I'm feeling okay, but my voice is not as good as it should be. Yeah. But let's push on.
Okay. And what's your background, Peter?
Right. Well, the next slide tries to put this. Richard Fielder did all this for me, a montage of things. On my mother's side, we're Welsh. They came from the Gower, which is west of Swansea, in a place called Rossilly. My grandmother's cousin was Edgar Evans, who went with Scott to Nantucket and died there. And also my great-grandfather actually was a ship's captain, which sailed the Broughton from Swansea to Australia and back, and died of malaria off of Chile. Mm. So he was a ship's captain. The family name was Bynum, apparently. That's actually a Norman area. And they say Swansea is supposed to stand for Swain's Eye, where he was a Viking king. So my background was on my mother's side, it was all Welsh. My father was born in Chiswick, actually. Went to Chiswick Grammar School.
It doesn't exist now.
No. I thought there was a place. Well, it probably doesn't now. But in fact, he got entrance, and then his father couldn't. They couldn't afford for the school uniform, and wouldn't let him go. So he copied his father's signature and went back and said, "Look, I've got to go because they've made me enter it." So they found the money somehow in one of those roads down to the Thames, which are probably worth a fortune now.
Yes, £4 million or so, I think.
There's a picture in the middle of Edgar Evans. He was, in fact, the strongest and biggest of the party. He was chosen to actually go to the final journey to the pole. He was Scott's favourite in many ways. He was he's actually drunk when he got on board the ship and fell in the water. Actually, he nearly didn't go. He died on the way back, the first one to die, because he was the biggest man. There are various theories about that. One theory was that he just needed more calories. And, of course, Scott relied more on less on dogs than Amazon did. And they had to eat their horses and so on. And lacking vitamin C and also the pure calories, being such a big and strong man, that's one theory in the history which suggests why he died so young. Died so early. There's a lot of controversy about Scott as a leader. One criticism was that Amundsen actually lived with the Eskimos. In other words, he learnt more about the terrain, he knew more about the importance of huskies, he knew more about survival than Scott did, and some say Scott was slightly arrogant in the way he went forward with that expedition. Others actually defends him and actually says, well, he may have been a somewhat arrogant leadership style, but if you'd done that journey as Fiennes has done it, you'd understand why he made some of those decisions. Like many great leaders, really, it's very difficult to make up your mind one way or the other about their style. But there's a feeling that he perhaps lacked some expertise, you know, in that area, which the opposition did have and actually gained. So I use the term in leadership about living with the Eskimos. And I think it was Aristotle who said that the great ship's captain is observing all the men on the board, all the women, and is observing the tides and the winds and everything else, and is watching what they're doing because they always do silly things. And he was actually emphasising the importance of knowledge, you know, as a leader, which we often overlook. And we're getting more and more a technical society. And if you're trying to manage a graphic design department now and you've got no experience in that area, in my view is that's difficult. Really, to make judgments about really what's going on. At the bottom, I was born in Wembley, or Alberton, south of Wembley, and Rich Field here got on Google Earth and shows 21 Woodside Avenue, where I was actually born, the two up, two down, which is at the bottom, which is very near the gyratory system at Hanger Lane. And I used to go fishing at the Grand Union Canal there as a boy, and I think my grandfather nearly kicked me in a few times, especially when I set him on fire when I was about 4 years old, and when I put an electric fire behind him and the actual seat caught light. And
so I'm seeing more connections now. I go to a Chinese restaurant in Alberton. So
right. Well, just round the corner from there is Woodside Avenue, and that's where I grew up.
So how would you compare, and you can see this is slightly scripted, but after a lot of, growing this together, if you can move on to the next slide, how does Scott's leadership style compare with this guy, Field Marshal Bill Slim?
Yeah, he became chief of the general staff, actually, because his abilities just could not be denied. Many people say that he was the greatest commander of the Second World War because he actually, they say, you could smell the soldiers' feet from his own boots. And he was actually a teacher who went to Sandhurst, moved right through the ranks to Field Marshal, and actually was extremely cunning in the way he actually trained his troops. He would train them well, made sure they were well fed. They absolutely adored him. And he learnt his experience and how to actually fight in the jungle so well. And he wrote a book, which was From Defeat into Victory, which is a massive bestseller. But what I liked about it in the book is that he makes a distinction between management and leaders. He saw them as very, very different things. And in the book he said, "We do not talk of management, but of leadership. There is a difference between leaders and management. Leaders represent one of the oldest, most natural, and most effective of all human relationships. Managers are a later product with neither so romantic nor so inspiring a history. Leadership is of the spirit, compounded of personality and vision. Its practice is an art. Management is of the mind, more a matter of accurate calculations of stats, methods, timetables, and routine. Its practice is a science. Managers are necessary. Leaders are essential. A good system will produce efficient managers, but we must find managers who are not only skilled, but inspired and inspiring leaders, which he saw as the next stage up. He did make reference, of course, that you need engineers as well. You know, the people actually are the technical experts to build the bridges and do the things that needed to be done in order to actually be effective in the battle place.
And presumably, you're able to describe that psychometrically?
Yep, that's a good lead-in. We haven't talked about this at all. What we did is that we took a whole series of personality self-report variables and rated 360. Right, so we actually looked at the factor structure. And when we took out the three biggest factors, it was intriguing to find that number three is what we called professional. And that was about documenting facts, interpreting data, meeting time schedules. They represent factor loadings, so they help us define the factor. Checking things, following procedures, managing tasks, which is very much but where one starts in occupation. You learn your trade. I learnt my trade at the National Foundation for Educational Research for 7-8 years, where we had a monopoly in all the psychometric tests available at the time. I mean, from the 16PF to the Wechsler scales, I worked in educational research, as well as clinical, and only 10% of our turnover was occupational. 90% was actually in the educational and clinical space. But the occupational field became more and more interesting to me. Then you've got the people side, which is more about management, which is about establishing rapport, resolving conflict, understanding people, 0.79, massive loading, team working, valuing individuals. So that's more management in Bill Slim's terms. Then you've come to pioneering. And this is the most powerful management style of all we found by looking at the performance of people who had this particular profile. Although it can be said that some people have got all three. They've got technical knowledge, they can manage people, and they've got vision as well. They're the sort of three P's leader. They're scarce, but very, very powerful. And here you'll find that they're more about strategy. They're more about generating ideas. They're creative. They prepare to make big decisions about directing people, and also very high on drive, taking action, seizing opportunities, and pursuing goals. So a great deal of energy in those sort of people. But as I said, you can be all three, but they're rare individuals.
At the end of this, we've got a few slides that show Peter's personality profile. And so you might want to be thinking as we're going through this what the scales are likely to look like, and then perhaps you can use your massive amount of skills and experience to interpret what you see. When we've been talking, Peter, we wanted this to be themed around leadership and entrepreneurship and so on, but there was another big theme that was coming out, which was around health. And there's a strong link, certainly in the book, to health and well-being, and it's a big thing on the agenda at the moment. So we're going to spend some time on that. But sort of related to that and other things, do you want to tell people a little bit about your earlier childhood?
Yeah, I was born at about 3 months. They discovered I actually had a bent spine. And so I spent the first 3 years of my life strapped in a leather a plaster at night with metal straps and being swung by my neck and being stretched to actually get the spine straight. It's called scoliosis. Now, congenital scoliosis is more common in boys than girls. They're not sure what causes it. Well, later on, scoliosis at 13 is much more common in girls than boys. Now, in fact, they leave the children alone, because it normally self-corrects. But apparently my mother, I'm not asking for sympathy, but when they were treating me, would hear me scream or go to the end of the garden in Wembley and put her hands over her ears, because as they pulled me and tried to stretch me, they now know that doesn't work. but it was a treatment of the late 1940s when you had this rather rare condition. When I asked my father about it, when he was about 80 years of age, he said he began to cry, and he said, well, we just try to make a game of it, Pete. Of course, there were also days when the parents weren't allowed to see you in hospital. It wasn't until Bowlby came along and actually said of the damage that actually can do to a child. They took you away for 2 weeks, put you in a cot, and you were just left there. Bowlby actually showed that this can cause maternal deprivation, you know, and actually caused a lot of stress to the child. And social isolation, interestingly enough, actually has been shown to be as powerfully a problem as physical abuse. Even more so in some studies. So that was a big thing in my family, a team of 30 people putting me through that procedure each day. One clinical psychologist friend said that shaped your character. That is, you're bloody-minded. You know, you're either going to take that and get on with it, or you know, you're going to fall over. I don't know, but that was a subjective view.
Well, let's have a look at how that did shape your character by looking at your early school reports.
Yeah, Richard, we dug this out. This is at Newnham School in Eastcote. And you can see that D's at the bottom 10% of the population. It was norm-based. So I was sort of D minus, D plus, C, et cetera, et cetera. Well, I just couldn't spell. I found spelling absolutely impossible. You know, I'd find 30 different ways to actually spell a word like pneumonia or something like that. Why doesn't it begin with an N? I couldn't see why it began with a P, you know, whatsoever. And it's still a problem I have to this day. There is evidence that any early child experiences like that do actually affect the short-term memory and spelling ability. It's quite but not conceptual memory, which is rather a different sort of memory.
Yeah, well, one of the things it does say on one of the reports is shows strong evidence of creativity. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, my father had kept this. I hadn't obviously kept it because I was very young then. It says, you know, ideas prolific. Yet I was in the bottom 5-10% of the population in academic achievement. It also says I talk too much, which I think is entirely wrong. But also played for the school at football, cricket, rounders. I was a sprinter for the school. I think a lot of the time I was too interested in wanting to play football than concentrate in the work, you know, in the actual school classroom. And it wasn't until at 13 they put me into a grammar school where they gave me a target to reach that I could go for it rather than continuous assessment, which didn't suit me because I was lazy. But when I had a target, I said, okay, I'll prepare for that exam. The same with spellings. I learnt mechanisms for actually memorising the spellings by using coping mechanisms. So I can see a word rather than hear it. Yeah, so I can see it rather than hear it. So I learn by the eye, not through the ear. And Rhea Reason found that quite a lot of children like that had a lot of ear infections when they're young, as I did. Children with scoliosis tend to actually have quite poor health, you know, because it can affect the lungs with that twist in the spine. It's often caused, by the way, by faster growth on the right than the left side. And so the left side will catch up. I'm extremely right dominant, and still am. And so basically what happens is the spine's a cartilage, yeah? It will bend if your muscles are stronger. So as you grow older, it will straighten. So that's why they leave them alone now, largely. So that's the peculiarity that I did terribly at school and in my early days at junior school, but gradually began to, you know, sort of get up with my peers.
So let's just shift things a little bit. One of the things that I asked Peter was, you know, on what would you play on Desert Island Discs? So we're going to just play a couple of bits of music, maybe the first 7-8 bars of each, and then we'll talk about why he chose these.
This is my first vinyl record.
Take these chains from my heart and set me free. You've grown cold and no longer care for me. All my faith in you my heart and set me free. Take these.
That was the first record I ever bought. That was one of the records on the LP by Ray Charles. My friends made fun of me because I adored it so much. I want to cry when I hear that. I think Sinatra called Ray Charles the only true genius in the business. And the influence he had on music is absolutely incredible. And so I bought that when I was about 11 years old. As soon as I heard it, I just wanted to get that and get the money together to actually buy it. So I've always been absolutely the complete fan of Ray Charles.
And then you were telling me about the impact it had on your father?
Well, my father loved music as well, and he would only listen to orchestral or opera. And one day he picked up this record, and he played it, and he came out crying. And he said, Pete, I said, why are you crying, Dad? He said, Pete, I never knew pop music could be like that, that good. He said he's got a timbre in his voice, which they say in opera, a quality in his voice, which is absolutely astounding. And, you know, he became a Ray Charles fan. He'd never listened to a pop song before. And these were times when the BBC wouldn't let us listen to pop music. We used to listen to Radio Luxembourg at 11 o'clock on a Sunday night under the sheets when Mum and Dad didn't know, to listen to what we want to listen to, which for me was mainly soul music. So he had a tremendous influence upon me, and I think other singers.
And you also made the point about, you know, in his 80s, he started to see the value of this.
In his 80s, he started to listen to another performer, which really surprised me. Rich? The game of life to win. You'll probably understand I like sad songs. But at 80, he listened to Dusty Springfield and he realised what a fantastic voice this woman had. And I saw a programme on the BBC about 6 months ago, and they had Elton John and really great, great singers, just saying she had an amazing voice. She got so nervous when she went on stage, but she could blast out a song. And I was having a meal. I met up with an old university friend. He's a professor of economics at Durham now. And he always we had Cream playing, Eric Clapton, at University of Leicester with my first degree. And he was much into, you know, rock. And I was much more into soul and was looked down upon. And I said, what a great voice Dusty Springfield had. I thought Brian Snowden would say, oh, no. He turned around over a meal and said, no, she had a voice. She had a voice. I wish she'd actually sung the blues. So my father, at 80, it was interesting to see that he was always looking to learn. And he could see and hear just the tremendous voice that this woman had. But the problems she went through, and nervousness when she got on stage, but when she got on that stage, she was another personality. What's intrigued me as well, in this area, I was watching a film, Amy Winehouse. I couldn't finish watching it. It was so moving. How could a woman with a voice like that, which is so absolutely brilliant, self-destruct? Her voice is amazing, absolutely amazing quality to that voice. And how many gifted people seem to set standards that nobody can ever reach, and what they put themselves through. As a psychologist, I find that frightening and intriguing at the same time.
Thank you, Peter. Let's move on then. Oh, and I found another connection. We both like Eric Clapton,
yes.
So that's good. I saw them at Royal Albert.
I'm seeing them Monday.
Yeah, you're seeing him Monday. And yeah. So all good there. Right, now, let's get back, although there was a lot in what you're saying
that
there
about... That was called the Surrey Delta, you know.
What?
Well, where we were in Epsom, Jimmy Page lived in Miles Road in Epsom. 5 miles down the road in Ripley was Eric Clapton. And 5 miles down the road in Sutton, okay, where I did a milk round when I was a student, was Jeff Beck. And at different times, they're all in the Yardbirds. And they've been rated, those three, in the top five musicians of all time, guitarists, with Jimi Hendrix, of course, as well, and sometimes Gilmour is in there. They called that the Surrey Delta. I saw Jeff Beck at the Albert Hall last year. Unbelievable, the way he plays that guitar as well.
And all I've got is that I live close to Anton Deck.
Very good.
All right.
Okay.
Let's move on then and not back to leadership, because clearly all of this is about it. And you know, we talk a lot about derailers, and you know, it happens in the music world and in the business world. But let's talk a bit about what led you to create SHL and take people on a bit of a tour through you know, the things that you kept in mind that made it successful.
Okay, well, after 7-8 years at the test division of the National Foundation for Education Research, I decided that, in fact, I would leave and start a company. And I was offered a company with HGS Management Consultants at Lane End, which isn't that far from here, on a 50-50 basis. I went to Roger Holdsworth, who was 10 years older than me, and asked him about advice on this, and he suggested we set up together, where I would have 65% of the shares and he would have 35% of the shares. I was already doing training on what they call level A, level B, but then there were 5 days and then 5 days. I was training on a 16PF, and on level A, I was training on the AH4, AH5, the Bennett tests, and so on. So I was already running those for HGS Management Consultants. So I decided after 7 years in the public sector, really, the bureaucracy was getting me down. In fact, on my leaving card, someone was written, I noticed, when we dug this out of our files, well done, you've shown it's possible to escape. Yeah. So I went out on my own, and then I was offered a retainer by Hodder and Stoughton on their educational list. I was employed by Mensa as their international consultant psychologist. They were interesting meetings, I can tell you, for a couple of years. And we didn't start Savile and Holdsworth until about 1977, until the September. But during those first 6 months, I had quite a lot of work. And the first course I ran when I was independent was in a town called Southport, where Kenny Dougal, where Gerard lives and Hanson live, the footballers, and Dalgleish live. And that's where my wife comes from now. I got up at 3 o'clock in the morning and drove the 4 hours up there to run it for a company called Plessy, which I think now gone out of business. But they were a massive company in the car industry some 30 years ago. So when I looked at the tests available, they're often using clinical tests. This is a bit extreme, what I've shown here, really. And they were often American. They were often inappropriate for the world of work. And I thought that surely we can do better. And companies like BP and Mars Confectionery came to me and said, look, if you start up, we'll back you. We'll buy from you. I'd already trained the people on courses, so I knew them personally. You had a pint with them in the evening. So they trialed for us. And people were using things like the TAT, the Thematic Apperception Test. If you can say it, you pass. You know. So basically, that was based on the work of Murray. I admire Murray's work. Don't get me wrong, I really do. He was a great psychologist. He invented the early assessment centres. He came over here to help with the early assessment centres. And this is one here, which my prof at university always showed. And apparently one answer he got to this, the man standing here with a woman in a bed, is that it's a man waiting for a number 93 bus, which must say something about the individual, but I'm not too sure what. And the other one is that in the British Leyland at the time, they were using the Vexler scales. And it involved giving senior managers jigsaws. Yeah, putting jigsaws together. So you took that and you had to put it into a jigsaw. What is that? Yeah, exactly. And I remember one manager saying, excuse me, but this is the way he put it. I've worked for this company for 25 years, but I never guessed my career would rest on whether I could put the tail on the arse of an elephant. So I was starting to get it, you know, that in, perhaps this isn't very appropriate for the world of work. Also, the vector scales had wrong questions in it. I know Steve here would know, but one of the questions is, at what temperature does water boil? Well, it's not one answer to that. On the top of Mount Everest, it's about 70 degrees centigrade. I mean, do they mean bar one? You know, it's an absolute errors in there. And also, it was full of questions about what is the theme of Genesis? What is the what are the five disputed books of the Testament, the Apocrypha? So it's extremely biased as an IQ test. So it's no wonder that you find people who weren't of a Christian or other background, you know, would actually perform less well on them. Incredibly biased. So the idea was, let's try and take job samples and put them in the psychometric framework and not go for this sort of clinical stuff.
Okay. And you've got a couple of slides that show some pre-SHL questions.
Well, the first question is things like, would I rather be a colonel than a bishop? And that's supposed to measure tough versus tender-mindedness. And I was told that this was a question by one well-known psychologist at the time, which couldn't be faked. So I asked 100 managers, what would you put if you were lying? And 98 said colonel, not bishop, you know, if they're applying for a management job. In fact, there's no way of writing questionnaire items in personality which can't be faked. You know, the best way is actually to interview the person on the questionnaire and look for validation of the information. In fact, I put up a test standards committee submission in about 1976 where people were given feedback, okay, on their own profiles, and it was refused by the test standards committee initially. But I was on the committee, so I argued for it. I was then 25. I said, if you're going to write character assassinations about people, they should have the right to know what you've written. If you can't justify it, yeah, then you shouldn't be writing it. So I challenged the then chair. So he said, well, there's a trial. You're allowed to actually do it and video it, and we'll see how it goes. And Helen Barron said I should write to the BPS because I've never been let off that trial. I think they now stand a part of the course that you actually have feedback sessions under the Data Protection Act. Because people would extrapolate ridiculous things about people and write things down which they have never had a right to challenge. You know, to me, that was wrong. I'd rather be more likely to admire the beauty of a poem than a well-made gun. That measures tough versus tender-mindedness. More than 50% of Americans kiss on their first date. That measured mating urge. It's about a bit out of date nowadays, I think. I have a fear of being buried alive. These actually did exist. There's very little love or companionship in my family. I believe in the second coming of Christ. There's something wrong with my sex organs. What?
We learnt about that at Sex and Superbrands last
night. Yeah. I mean, that's that they're in the MMPI, and that was being used in America for selection. They got sued heavily for this. Millions and millions of dollars of class action against companies. What psychologists were putting this sort of stuff up? Didn't they have any common sense? I mean, would you ask this sort of thing in an interview? Anyway, so we were dealing really with a great opportunity which we could grab if we could actually produce the things in a much more job-relevant and acceptable way, almost taking job samples but using psychometric rigour.
Mm. So, and there's a few other slides we've got here that demonstrate that we go through reasonably pacily so that we get into opposition.
Very quickly, my PhD was on Cattell factor structure in 1977. It was Dr. Rainer Kurtz that noticed that when I factor analysed it, there was a big five. He said, Peter, he came to me about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, said he saw my PhD, he read it, he said, look, you've got the big five there using Promax. And I hadn't realised it at the time. That was in 75. But one method of validation, which Cattell, who did great work, but some of the instruments he produced weren't that tremendously good. The items, I think he got students to write. He was more interested in the very complex stats, was to give profiles of average of people and select against that average profile. This is one profile from the 16PF manual at the time. I'm not knocking Cattell and his work at all, because he did some very, very great things for psychology. But this is a profile of accountants. Okay. So it's so much down the middle, yeah? And the next profile, any guesses what this is? Now, some of you might know. Oh, you turned, you told them. But I got this from Wandsworth Prison. This is, in fact, the profile of convicted armed bandits, 360 of them. They're very similar to the accountants. Now, the problem with this is...
As we well know.
Yeah. The problem with this is the relatively unsuccessful armed bandits, because they've been caught. What I'd like to see is the guys who haven't been caught. They may be a lot brighter than these. Yeah. So to take the average of the people you've got does not improve selection. What you've got to do is look at the high performers versus the low performers. But you'll still find organisations coming in and saying, oh, we'll profile your managers and we'll select that template. Well, all you're doing is replicating the sins of the past. You've got to have some criterion of job success. I know that's difficult. There's no such thing as objectivity in any criterion, but you can try in given areas. Even sales performance is not completely objective. It's influenced by many factors, location, your boss and other factors and so on, and opportunity and luck. Okay, moving on.
Yeah, so... Yeah, we've got that one. Let's check what next. Right. Yes, yeah, so a little bit about where you started.
Right. Having moved from the NFER, we had to get an office. So on the top left-hand side is where Savile and Holdsworth started. And that arrow is the place where the ability test of SHL was started. And downstairs, there's a little garage there with a car in front. That's where we supplied our test from. From my garage. In 21... Common Road, Claygate, Esher, Surrey. Now, Rich, not at the same time, you lived down there.
Yeah, same road.
How big was that room?
Same house, but just flipped the other way around.
How big was that room?
Absolutely minuscule room, just a tiny little single bed.
If I did that, could I touch the walls?
So
to keep our costs down, I worked from there. And then, because we... Never. Roger offered to put £10,000 into the company, but we never had to. In our first year, we flew, absolutely flew, mainly from training income. And all of that money went back into R&D. And we didn't have the overhead costs of an office. So then I got a bigger house around the corner, and that little window there is where I sat and developed the OPQ. I started at 6 o'clock one night, and I finished at 8 o'clock the next morning to finish what's called the concept model of the OPQ. And in fact, that's still the one that's largely available to this day. Although, actually, I was writing 13 items per scale, where now I know I could have done it in 6, not 13. Very repetitive. So that was literally around the corner, and that was in the Avenue in Claygate. And down below was where Roger Holdsworth lived in Putney, where he had a secretary. Roger's background was different from mine. He was 10 years older than me. He was fantastic at languages. He spoke about 8 languages. He went to Marlborough, to Cambridge. I was Stony East Secondary Modern, to Leicester University. But we made a good team. He was much more structured than I was. And Steve can talk better than I can about that, because I had no structure whatsoever. But he was much more structured. He was great. He was a great psychologist. He was tremendous in looking after the accounts and things of that kind. And I got on more with the sales, the academic work, and training, which I always enjoyed, being on the training floor. I enjoyed that more than anything. So that was Roger's house, as it is today, in Marlbrook Road in Putney, because I decided to join him rather than go with HGS Management Consultants and join up. And then a year later, I sold 15% of my shares to Roger for £15, which was not my cleverest move. But nevertheless... It may not have taken off as quickly without his full-time employment, because he was running a company called Holdsworth Audiovisual. Mm. He already had a number of companies running. Okay, the next slide. Well, what we decided to do really shook the establishment. The bottom right-hand side, we produced a brochure in colour. My goodness, the reaction, the negativity we got to that. A brochure?
and colour. You can't have this. Psychologists are not professional. When we'd taken over at NFER, the test of the NIIP, I went down to Wimpole Street and I spoke to the director. It had gone broke. And I went round and they had paper which was parchment-like and yellow. And I said to the director, and this is a cheeky 26-year-old, excuse me, Mr. Buzzard, Dr. Buzzard, but this is unusual paper. This is 1975. He said, well, paper was very difficult to get a hold of during the last war. I thought, you've had this in stock since what? It's for 30 years. And I said, well, what sells most? He said, sells most? We're not in trade, you know. They didn't know what they were actually selling. Also, they were making losses. There was actually a law that said you couldn't increase prices, so they didn't. But they didn't realise you could if you're making a loss. So to save the pension fund, they closed the NIP. And they were the first people in Britain to do market research. If you remember Black Magic Chocolates? It's the NIP that did 7,000 people for Roundtree's on that. And they decided to do no more of that work. It was too capitalist. And it was lost to psychology, to market research agencies. They did some great work, but it just declined, you know, to more commercial organisations. So the bottom right hand was designed by my brother, and my brother was the chief designer at the stationery office. He was quite a well-known graphic designer. And we also brought him in to do our early tests. And we actually printed in colour. You know, because I felt strongly that when you present test materials to people, if they're dirty, if they're foreign, they're badly spelt, if they look old-fashioned, it's bad branding to the applicant. They're spending millions, well, almost millions, on their graduate recruitment program, who then present this tatty stuff. It's a bad image to project to the candidate. So why not do it well? Bring in professional graphic designer to make it look good. But rest it on good science. Make sure that you've got good manuals. There's good reliability, validity, and normative data as well. So combine the two. Make it commercial, but make sure you have good science back behind it. So that's what we did, and that really rocked the boat. And that was actually a surprise even to the Americans. When I presented at PSYOP, and I had coloured slides, they went, what? You've got coloured slides? I've always believed that actually academics take you more seriously if your slides are scrawled and you can't read them. If they're well presented, they're suspicious, you know, immediately. Yeah. So we combine good graphic design, presentation, and good courses, and consultancy, and I think scientific principles with good presentation. And they just sold like hotcakes.
So, Peter, I think there's a main theme that comes out from the next slides, which I think you've said, and so I'd like to skip a little bit, which is about how you looked at the market, you looked at what was basically not good about it, and what needed to be improved, and what you offered in terms of products and services was better than that. And there's also one, the technology slide, the piece of technical equipment.
I found a machine, it was developed in Finland, it was part of a big jump jet deal, believe it or not, and this is a document reader. You fed in an answer sheet and it could actually read. It's called a Valmatic. We used to call it an Evilmatic machine. We then got it connected to an early computer, a desktop computer, so we could feed answer sheets in, it could read the actual multiple choice options. We wrote programs of item analysis, so we could turn out the item analysis reliability using CUDA Richardson and then alpha coefficients so quickly. We used to let this run overnight in my upstairs bedroom, and so by the end, the next morning, we had all of the data, the item analysis, we could choose the items, and we could prepare them and get them ready for print. So we use early technology to actually push forward development. So within 2 years, we had a whole range of some 20 different tests.
So whilst I was playing Hungry Horace on the ZX81, you were punching data in through machines. Can we go to the slide with the swimming pool? Can you describe your leadership style?
Chaotic. Okay.
In 1987, I was getting fed up with running courses in hotels with bad food, bad accommodation, people moaning about that, and when I was trying to run a good course. We had so many courses running, sometimes as many as 20, with 16 people on them. We couldn't cope in the local environment or area for the hotels. We were filling them up. So I acquired a training centre and spent a year redeveloping it with architects and builders. And I added a swimming pool to it because I learned from Trust House Forte that, in fact, when people choose a hotel, 80% put swimming pool as number one for its choice, but only 8% use it. Intriguing. So I thought that what we'll do is have excellent food, excellent training rooms, a little golf course around it, a good gym, tennis courts where we could play five-a-side football for my football team as well. But the main thing about it was the choice of the staff. They were fantastic staff. And I put them all through level A course, the waiters and waitresses. So when they did correlation on a Wednesday, they would say, oh, you're doing correlation today, are you? So you're going into the product moment, oh. I mean, the delegates weren't going, what? You've done the course. And I wrote that course at the 75th percentile. It kept people moving. Yep. And so we won a number of awards for that particular course. They've been cut down now quite considerably because I always taught how to calculate a correlation coefficient because by that you could then understand reliability and validity so easily. It only takes 20 minutes using the Z-score formula to actually show that. But basically we acquired our own management centre and I used to be like to get in the training room and we always try to put people who were well experienced in the training room. We didn't put new grads to run the courses because they didn't have the war stories. If you got the war stories, you so much improved the courses. And that meant people referred us on and on and on and on and on. So most of our expansion came from referral. People saying, we really enjoyed that course. Now I want an in-house course for all of my people. It's not true that I'm strangling Roger there, as some people said at the time. But actually, Roger. Down in the bottom here, we've got Kevin Young, and that's an international event with lobster. We didn't do that every day. But our chefs won international prizes. And also, we pre-ordered material in the morning, so we had very little wastage. So our overheads for food was not high. So what we did in every way, coffee was going 24/7. Not when they wanted it, the hotel, but when I wanted it. So we did everything we could to understand the delicate perspective. Even the chairs we made sure had high backs and were comfortable. So we looked at every single detail. It's a funny thing. There's a difference between detail consciousness and being a perfectionist. I'm low on detail conscious, but in this, I was absolutely a perfectionist. If I saw a bit of paper on the floor, my staff would run around like hell in case I saw it. Say, pick it up quick, because it gives a bad... But this became our vanguard, the management centre, and we had 98% occupancy rate. It's absolutely incredible for a hotel. But I believe we ran damn good courses. And also, we used tests in selecting our consultants. And we had damn good consultants. They were bright, they were hardworking, they were sociable. I remember I went over to the Albert Pub with, I think, IBM, it was someone like that, or maybe, sorry, ICL. And they said, you select clones. I said, what do you mean I select clones? This is a client. They said, well, all your consultants are bright, they're knowledgeable, they're sociable, you know, and so on. I said, well, if that's a clone, give me more. Give me more. They're hardworking, they're sociable, they're bright, they know what they're doing, and so on. I said, fine. We put a lot of effort into our selection procedure. A lot of those people went on to form their own organisations, and I'm proud of that. I didn't see that as competition. It was nice to see young people moving through. So my management style was to develop people, because I can't do it all. It's only by expansion. Even Charles Handy, the guru of management, came to me once at a conference and said, you got it right. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you've got, you know, 350 psychologists all running that course. He said, they only want me. But you've actually got them out here running that course. But we gradually brought them up so they could bring it up to run it themselves and run it very, very well. So my management style is I'm not I am not detail conscious on people. I believe in selecting good people, giving them targets. They always used to say, don't go to Peter with a good idea, because he'll turn around and say, right, go away for 2 weeks and come back with a solution. But my door's open. You can come and ask me. If you want advice, I'll give you my advice. Yeah? But you go away and think about it, and the good ones will come back with a solution. And they're the people that you want. Only through that can you grow an organisation to 1,500. We intended to only have 12 in it, Roger and I, in one state. We ended up with 1,500 worldwide. But my management style, this is the maintenance manager picking me up, because I would have a beer with him on a Friday afternoon and the others with my staff. And that's how much respect they gave me. I was the chairman. They picked me up and threw me in the pool on the opening ceremony of it. When we had the summer events, I used to go in the stocks. They used to throw tomatoes at me, and the money would go for charity. So basically, I did not try to be a myopic manager. Get good people, give them objectives, train them well, encourage their development. It's really, really nice to see those young people develop through to run more senior departments or go out alone if they wish. Right, move on.
So let's go to the next slide. We wanted to talk a little bit about struggle, because clearly in getting to the level of success you've had, you know, struggle is part of it. And there's a slide here which talks about, which, you know, for you was quite a major deal, right? That suddenly the media started to move against psychometrics.
Well, a paper came out in Nature magazine, which was not refereed, which actually got the stats wrong on a book done by Tony Bukowski. And it all he did was report a series of validation studies. But we did not put all of the coefficients in, only the ones of effect size. And this was written, and we got attacked and attacked and attacked. I was on the business program about personality questionnaires are completely invalid. When we showed they were, had validity, we couldn't get any coverage. You know, good news is never going to go in the papers. But that was quite emotional for me, because it felt as if I was being a con man, you know, by using questionnaires. I think they got a part to play. I'm not suggesting that you shouldn't interview people well. Of course not. I'm not suggesting you shouldn't use assessment centres, ability tests, structured interviews, etc. To me, psychometrics is not an end in itself, but a tool. I'm by background an arts graduate. I wanted to do maths A-level and English, but they wouldn't let me. They clashed. So I did English, in a sense, politics, geography, history. And I wasn't allowed to do maths. I had to do a maths test to get into my course at the University of Leicester. But that ended up my area. So basically, that was quite a personal attack. But as it's happened, I think personality does exist. There is such a thing. It went through a stage with Michelle's work, who was suggesting there was no such thing as personality at all. So that was quite personal for me, I must admit.
And then we've already talked about health, and there's the next slide that shows something else that you had to deal with.
Well, what happened was, I was running a course for Jaguar Land Rover. I got a phone call from my wife, my ex-wife, my first wife, and said that you've got to have a major molar tooth out. And I was taken up to Preston, and the actual dentist took 4 hours to try and get it out. I didn't know I had roots like my father, very deep, and they twist all the way down. He couldn't get it out. He had to call another dentist who played squash, he said, to rip it out of my face. And he never did an x-ray. And now Professor Tara Renton, who's an expert in this area, said he should have split it about 4 or 5 ways and taken it out. So he ripped it out. It got an infection. Ever since then, I've had toothache. It's pain in the face. It's called a form of trigeminal neuropathy. They damage what's called the trigeminal nerve here. And when that myelin sheath is damaged, it never recovers. They're working on stem cells to try and actually get around this. When you're under constant pain of toothache, it can get you down. And what you get is called wind-up of the central nervous system. The brain doesn't like it. It starts pushing out its own painkillers. One of those is noradrenaline. Noradrenaline is fight and flight hormone. When you get ready to fight or fly, the brain immediately makes responses. It pumps sugar through the body, glucose. It immediately pushes oxygen to the major muscles
If you're going to run or you're going to fight, you're going to need it. It makes your skin cold because it doesn't need it there. So what happens with the wind-up, with constant pain, is a lot of noradrenaline gets pushed out. So I became very ill because I started to get pain, not just here, but all the way down my body. I didn't know what was going on. They said it was depression. I was given ECT, wrongly. I was given antidepressants. They made me worse.
ECT?
Electroconvulsive therapy. Yes, I was given ECT.
So
it did no good. And in fact, the third occasion, when I woke up, they had no crash team. And I had to rush anaesthetists away from a local hospital to get me back. I had not breathed for 3 minutes. And when I woke up, all my trousers were wet. They'd forgotten to take me to the toilet because they give you a muscle relaxant. I said, I'm not going through this again. I'm not going through this again. And Leslie Parkinson, who's a well-known psychologist, said, why on earth did they give you that? Why on earth did they give you that? I said, I'm not having any more. So I started research and condition myself for 2 years. If we can move on. Oh, the scream, if you know that thing, is supposed to be trigeminal neuralgia. Trigeminal neuralgia, I don't get it as badly as that, is the most painful condition known to man. When you get it, you get an electric shock right through your body. You just collapse to the floor with the pain because the trigeminal nerve goes into the pons, straight into the middle, and the whole brain lights up in pain. Those people are in a terrible state. It's worse than childbirth, women that have children say. It's terrible. I don't get it that badly. I just get generalized body pain and pain in the face. So when I was lucky enough to get a Lifetime Achievement Award in 2000 by the BPS, that's me in the top right-hand corner. I'd gone to 24 stone. I then spent 2 years, 3 years, researching and conditioning myself at the Royal Society of Medicine, who made me an associate member. And I took 350 references, and although I can't cure it, I realized that anti-seizure drugs could actually work in this condition, which I take to this day. And that is me 3 years later. I'd lost about 10 stone in 3 years. So there's the proof of the pudding. And I got my vitality back. I could think again in that condition. And when I was 24 stone, I couldn't think straight. And that's why I gave up the chair of SHL. And then they wanted to get rid of Roger Holdsworth at SHL, wanted me to vote against him at a board meeting, and I said, no, I'm not voting against my co-founder. We were not socially close. Roger and I were very different characters. But I was not going to vote against my co-founder, and I had the backing of Manpower, massive, you know, recruitment group. And David Artless on the board was also a psychologist. We were three, and we felt they got the policies wrong at the time. They went on to lose 70 million in the next 6 years. 70 million. Because they thought our strategy was wrong. We lost by just 2% in an EGM, as it turned out. And that was very stressful for me. But they asked me back within 2 weeks. They asked me back within 2 weeks to rejoin as president. And I said, no, I'm going to start again. And that's why I started Savile Consulting.
Yeah, just a quick time out. I know that we've been going for an hour, and we didn't put an end time on this, but I just want to check with you that you're okay to continue with this. We're probably at 10-15 minutes. You good?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
You then spent some time in Barbados.
to help my health. He's my health, you see. So I bought a place in Barbados. This is my wife, Jermaine. In Barbados, and to fund Savile and Holdsworth, I bought a house, I redeveloped all the cellar, I put in a gym, bedrooms and things
Savile
like
consulting.
That.
Savile Consulting.
Savile Consulting, yeah. Sorry. Always get confused. and then we built a villa, this one here, which we sold to the winner of the, it came from Newport, the winner of the Eurojackpot. And I used that money to fund Savile Consulting, so we were not holding to a bank. I don't like to be holding with banks. Sorry if I'm from a bank. I like to have cash in the bank. So we developed these two villas in Barbados, which I sold to fund Savile Consulting, effectively, and also bought a villa in the Algarve, which I still keep.
which I also extended as well, effectively. But I love the Algarve. I find the Portuguese extremely friendly. There's some very good golf courses around there as well. Okay.
I've just found another connection. I have a place in Portugal too.
Hey, good. Okay, we've got lots. But so basically, if you want about... I'm sorry if it looks a bit show-offy, but in developing these places, I sold them, and then that went into development of money, into R&D, into Savile Consulting and development of WAVE questionnaire. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, you're going to put me through the mill.
Well, I was going to do this, and I thought, actually, the audience can do a good job of this. So could you just flick through these four slides? So, you all would be familiar with this. So there's the thinking, the influence, the adaptability, and the delivery. So you can notice some points on that. Would just go back to the thought again. So any themes coming out there?
These are STEN scores. So a 10 STEN is the 99th percentile. So it's top 98 to 99, as you know.
Is that what you've experienced from listening to Peter and for those that know him? Yeah. And then for influence? I mean, this I've retaken for you
in the last 3 weeks.
Okay.
No, it's not an old one. It's not contrived. I've tried to do it honestly. It's both ipsative and normative. So it's ranking and rating. Salgado and Anderson have recently found that combination gives best validity. You combine the two. And that's what we did with WAVE. It gives better validity than normative on its own. So the rank order they found of validities was... quasi-ipsative, normative and ipsative, then ipsative, then normative. And Salgado's a great psychologist. He's got no test publishing rights, but he said we're going to have to turn over all that we've said in the last 50 years. That rank order scales can actually give you good validity.
There was one question that actually Lucy asked me related to this, which is just to consider if you put up the drive one, the delivery one, and it's a 10 on drive. So is success about drive or about delivery and or both? And where does it really come from?
Well, it's about all of it, isn't it, really? I mean, it's no good having a Ferrari if you don't turn it on. Okay, if you don't turn the ignition on. So, I mean, I think we found out now, us Oxykes, that if you want to be successful in most jobs, then being... quite clever or smart, I don't know what I am, but if you're smart and you work hard, you tend to succeed in most occupations. It's taken us 100 years to find that out. And we've made real progress, you know. But I think things like creativity and innovation are coming forward more and more in the modern workplace. Driven, yeah, I suppose I am. That's brought back a dark side in my life because I would often work 18, 19 hours a day without stop. And that has been, I think, for my family, quite hard to take on occasions. Mm. I mean, as I said, with the OPQ, I started one night, and I think I got it, and I went right the way through the night, and then I had it after 4 years of research. You sort of assimilated it, and it then came about how it could be assembled. Mm. And that was quite common for me even to this day. I will sometimes get up at 3 and not finish at 11 o'clock at night. It's all very well about me time. I admire that, but in big corporations where you're on a global contract, my phone's got to be on 24/7. Mm-hmm. It's got to be there 24/7 because I could have a major contract coming in from Hong Kong or from China or from Australia, unless I'm onto it like a rocket, and I would be on like a rocket before my opposition, I won't leave it a couple of days. Mm-hmm. I'll be there in that office literally in hours. Mm-hmm. So I was always very quick to spring to the opportunity.
And another question, seeing as we're in the kind of psychometric bit, which was from Ben here on LinkedIn, I asked if anyone had any questions. I know you like this question. He asked, if you were to introduce a new psychometric to exploit a gap in the market right now, what construct would you seek to measure?
I'm thinking about that one. But I'm not going to give it away, am I? Next one.
Okay. Look, we can say a little bit, if you like, about your strong connection between to sport and the work you've done on connecting high performance in sport to what we can learn in business, and then I have two questions to finish. So if you'd like to say
Sport's been my life. I mean, my PAs and secretaries always knew on Tuesday and Thursday I was football training. No conferences on Tuesdays nights because I was out there football training. And if in fact I wasn't good enough to get in the team, I would develop a new team myself. That was the answer, start a new team. So I would make sure I always get into it. So I played till I was 50. I played squash till I was 50 and tennis at that age as well. I play tennis still, but I've ruined my knees. I played against Wimbledon when they were amateurs and a guy jumped in from 8 foot into my right leg when I was playing men's football when I was 15. I was 6'1" then. And that was when Wimbledon were the crazy gang later on, and they would maim you, basically, the way they played. And this 30-year-old went into my knee with both his feet, so I've had to have it replaced. And unfortunately, it's come loose, so they've got to take it out and put another one in. So I'm looking forward to that operation. But nevertheless, that was my life, very much. And in sport, you ask for a funny story. I think one of the funniest I heard, we did a book, Tom Hopton and I, and Richard Cross is here as a co-author of it, and we got Gareth Edwards, a hero of mine called Stan Bowles, fantastic footballer. But the trouble was he was drinking and he was actually womanising and he was basically gambling all the time. Someone said, Stan, if you could pass the Ladbrokes bookmakers as well as you pass the football, you'd be a millionaire. But it was that George Cohen that told me a story about 1966 World Cup when England were playing Portugal in a semi-final and Portugal had a fantastic black player called Eusebio. He was so quick. I think he got the most goals in the World Cup and they had to stop him. He played against South Korea and got about six goals or something ridiculous in the previous game. They were losing 4-0 and he came in about six goals. So they had to deal with him. So apparently Sir Alf Ramsey, sat down at a table and brought over this player called Nobby Stiles. He always called him Norbert. He said, and George Cohen played fullback in the team. And he heard the conversation. He said, Norbert, come here, please. So he sat down there. He said, yes, Alf. He said, Norbert, we've got to take care of Eusebio. We've got to take care of Eusebio. You're the man to do it. He said, wherever he goes on that pitch, I don't want you 1 inch away from him. If he's up front, you're with him. If he's in the middle of the field, you're with him. If he goes to fullback, you're with him. If he goes in goal, you're with him. You've just got to negate him. We take him out, yeah? Then we can win. We've got to just take him out of the game, and you've got to take him out. And apparently Nobby Stiles said, yes, Alf. He said to him, for the game or for life? Seriously, that's what you say. And he said that little man followed Eusebio all over the pitch, and he never got a kick except for one penalty, and he came off crying. He wasn't as quick as him, but through his intelligence, yeah, he followed him everywhere and negated him, and they won and went forward to win, of course, against West Germany. About the only times we've ever beaten the Germans, I might add. Okay.
Peter, last
question. That's George Cohen there. That's Stan Bowles on the far right-hand side. Fantastic player for Queen's Park Rangers. Unfortunately, he's now developed Alzheimer's, and all the money from the programmes 2 weeks ago at QPR went to help him. What a gift. Terry Venables said he was the best player he ever played with. He played for England and everything else, but if he'd really concentrated, he's another Pelé.
And we're not going to go into it now, but I think the next slide talks about, it has Tony Adams on there, who you've got a great YouTube video where you're interviewing him and talking about leadership, worth checking out at some point.
I've got to know Tony very well. And on YouTube, there's something called The Art of Leadership. If you want to see a footballer organising a back four, then see that. I'm not an Arsenal supporter, but the way he condenses the play, go there, go here, lets everybody know. The way he pushed people up, his offside track was so clever. If you ever saw the film The Full Monty, they say, how do we line up? They say, like Tony Adams. And that back four, I think one season only let about 12 goals in all season. And he says it wasn't the best players he'd ever played with. But they practice and practice and practice and practice and practice the unit. And he pushed it up. And he's 6'4½". And I saw a program with Ferguson on leadership talking. He said, that's the man I wanted. He was a Man United player in an Arsenal shirt, but he refused to leave Arsenal. He captained England, and he consoled Beckham when he was sent off against Argentina. He consoled him when he was crying in the changing room afterwards for being sent off. And he had a heart attack about 6 weeks ago. It's unbelievable, because he was training and he felt pains in his chest. One artery was 99% blocked, he said. But they saved him with stents, and he's okay now. And he's no fat on him. He's no fat on, but his father had a heart attack at the same age. So in fact, we're back to the genes, I'm afraid, perhaps. So the Art of Leadership is on YouTube with Adele singing in the background. Just watch the way he organises a back four. And then there's one, which is not as good, of me interviewing him on his personality test results. His 10-10 leadership. No mucking around. Telling everybody exactly what needs to be done. Real expertise. Very clever. He's a clever man, actually. And he's actually quite shy. He's quite shy. But when he gets on that football field, God help you.
So I have one last question, and then I'm going to say a few things, and then I'm going to kind of bring this to a close so that if anyone wants to go, they can. And then if anyone wants to stay and ask Peter some questions, then if you're okay with that, then we'll open it up to that. So last question for you. What are you most proud of?
I think I'm most proud. I saw a review. It was either McKinsey's or Bain & Co., which looked at about 20 HR activities about what had most impact on the bottom line of an organisation. What activity had most impact on improving profitability? What do you guess it was? Yeah, getting the right person in the right job. So if I've made any contribution in my life about getting the right person in the right job, in the right culture, and they've enjoyed that job and they've progressed in that job to the benefit of the organisation, the individual, and hopefully the economy. If it's only the tiniest of contributions, I feel proud. The second thing I feel proud of is, in fact, many of the very gifted people that have come, joined us as graduates and moved on, that one has managed to help on their way, and that has been incredibly enjoyable for me. And of course, by doing that, I couldn't do everything myself. You've got to be able to actually develop other people, in my opinion, if you expand a business. Mm. Don't hold in the knowledge yourself. I love being told I'm wrong. Actually, I was often told I'm wrong by a new grad, and they were right. But when you get into a PLC, which we not talk about, they knew they made wrong decisions. But they wouldn't go against them in case it made them look silly. I wasn't used to that culture. They would not change a decision, even though it was clearly wrong. I couldn't tolerate that. So that was a good reason to get out and start again, really. So I've left Towers Watson. They're a good company, but I'm not corporate man. I'm not a man or woman for 45,000 people. It's just not me. So I enjoy developing companies, and the skills of actually developing a company and being an entrepreneur are different from being a chairman of a PLC, which is much more structured, detail conscious, and all that sort of stuff. Mm. And I hate bureaucracy. Oh, do I hate it. So I'm really not, I haven't got the skill set, I think, really, to be a PLC chairman or chairperson, because I like developing things, and that's different.
Mm. When I was talking to Peter in preparing for this, I think I've been talking about this bottle of water, sparkling water, and some of you may not have heard this yet, so I'm just going to say it again. Bear with me. Because I've been told...
It's not a ship, is it?
You're not going to hit me with it. I'm not going to hit you with it.
And would you like us to say
just
what?
Yes, yes. In ode to Steve Chapman, absolutely. So what the connection I'm making, which I really hope that we all start to use, and Ben has already done this in his session, is that imagine this sparkling water is an organization, and it is full of bubbles, But you only see the bubbles when you take the cap off. And is that like psychology in organizations, that it's there, it's just that, you know, it's not always visible. And our role is to make it more visible in organizations and ensure that it's taken into account more in the decisions and the ways that organizations are shaped. Now, the connection back to Peter. When I said to him, look, in doing this interview, what I want to do is bring out loads of psychological factors, yeah, and what are the psychological underpinnings of what you do? And his first response was, well, you know, I don't really do that. I just do what I do. You know, it wasn't an immediate, oh yes, I use this model and I use this theory and so on and so forth. And then he spoke to Binah Condola about it, who said to him, Peter, don't be ridiculous. You defined this entire industry. And, you know, you may or may not have views on that, but I certainly didn't hear that and think that was unreasonable. I was like, well, yeah, actually, who did I come across first in this industry? It was you. Who did I respect and admire in this industry first? It was you. And that seems like a reasonable thing. And so in honor of that, you know that we have already given one honorary membership to the ABP in recognition of service to the ABP. And I would also like to offer Peter you honorary membership of the ABP in essence because of your service to this industry.
Oh, it's very, very good of you. I didn't know you were going to do that.
Well, no, you didn't.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Whoops. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm not drinking at the moment because I'm on antibiotics, but I will later. Thank you.